This is Montage.
The aquifer? That's the stuff that they put on fish to keep them warm.
What's an aquifer? How long does a diaper take to decompose? Go out on the streets with our Montage cameras as we test South Florida's environmental IQ. Plus,
we go to buy some soup at the store, and it comes with this plastic bowl, and it comes with all this plastic wrapping, and then an extra cardboard box. Why do we need that?
Is your trash good garbage or bad garbage? We'll show you how to sort through the mess. Tread new ground with a local artist who makes sure you'll never tire of old tires. And champion for wildlife and the environment, Marjory Stoneman Douglas turns 100 today. Plus, an award-winning signature video capturing the beauty and the beast of the Everglades. On tonight's Montage.
Hello, welcome to Montage. I'm Ed Odell. Do you like to eat? How about breathing? I enjoy doing it every couple of seconds, and I'd like to keep on doing it, and that's the point of Earth Day. It's a worldwide effort to raise awareness and put a halt to mistreating the Earth, because if we don't start paying attention to our planet, there might not be one left for us to live on. We here at Channel 4 are proud to be your official Earth Day station, and tonight we're kicking off Earth Month with an entire show to entertain and inform about the world around us. But first, how about a little pop quiz? We sent Channel 4's Katrina Daniel out to see just how much South Floridians know when it comes to the planet they live on.
Open the booklet. Begin part two. Good luck.
Remember the tension of taking a test? The sheer pressure enveloping the entire classroom? Well, relax. Our quiz is based on fact and fun. For trivia about our planet, we took our environmental quiz to Coconut Grove. For grades, we went to FIU environmental specialist Jack Parker. Question number one. How long does it take for a disposable diaper to decompose?
You got me. Seriously, decompose? 2 days.
9 years. I'm laying the disposable diapers.
Depends, about 3 hours, no?
Give or take 500 years. Cloth diapers take only 1 to 6 months to decompose. Americans throw away 18 billion disposable diapers a year, enough to stretch to the moon and back 7 times. Question two, what's ozone or the ozone layer?
Something that surrounds the Earth from outside.
The ozone layer is what protects us from a lot of the pollutants, and it's disappearing, so we're all gonna fry.
The ozone layer? What is the ozone layer?
Ozone is a chemical form of oxygen that exists in the stratosphere that shields us from ultraviolet radiation.
The ozone layer is an invisible shield surrounding the Earth. Air pollution has been breaking this layer down, increasing skin cancer, reducing crops, and the number of fish. Question number three, what's an aquifer?
Aquifer is a tree. It's something that has a soil or tree, one of the two.
A marine life, plant life, is it?
No.
No. Okay.
The aquifer? That's the stuff that they put on fish to keep them warm.
Nice try.
An aquifer is porous rock under the ground in which groundwater is stored, which can serve as a source for drinking water.
Dumping oil and other toxins on the ground can seep into the aquifer and contaminate our drinking water. Question number four, how much water does it take to flush a toilet?
A gallon.
About 25 gallons.
4 or 5 gallons, I guess.
Good guess. The typical toilet uses 5 to 7 gallons each flush. Toilet flushing makes up 45% of all in-home water consumption. Bathing takes up to 30%. Laundry and dishes, 20%. And drinking and cooking, the other 5. Here are some water-saving tips. Put a plastic container with water inside your tank. It can save 1,000 gallons of water each year. Turning off your faucet while brushing your teeth saves 3 to 5 gallons each minute. Hand washing dishes can take up to 20 gallons of water, while a full dishwasher will use just under 10. Question number five, what's the greenhouse effect?
Something you have in your garden?
It's a club.
A new restaurant down here.
The greenhouse effect is an effect caused by gases in the atmosphere trapping heat on the Earth, causing the Earth to warm up.
The burning of fuel contributes to this unnatural warming effect. It is upsetting the entire balance of nature, and if the trend continues, some say polar ice caps could melt and flood coastal areas like South Florida. Question number six, how many trees would be saved if America recycled just the Sunday paper?
2,000.
100,000.
20 million.
The correct answer is 500,000. Question number 7. What happens when you breathe carbon dioxide?
You die.
Your lungs get intoxicated.
It kills you, doesn't it? That's how you kill yourself.
That's carbon monoxide.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
When you breathe carbon dioxide, very little happens as long as you have enough oxygen. It is not a toxic gas. Plants convert carbon dioxide into oxygen.
And finally, question number 8. How tall is the Dade County landfill?
I have no idea.
500 feet. 50 stories.
Well, not yet. Dubbed Mount Trashmore, the Dade County landfill had to be trimmed down to a whopping 150 feet. The mountain of debris stands about as tall as this 10-story building.
Now, that's a lot of trash, and what's even scarier is with American families producing 100 pounds of garbage each week, we'll need 500 new dumps a year to put it in.
Coming up next.
As far as I know, this is just an extra fancy piece of garbage to fill up your garbage can with.
Sorting through recycling, and still ahead, radial art.
Have you gone through your garbage lately? You'd be surprised to learn that a lot of the stuff you throw away is the slick packaging the product came in. As Channel 4's Susan Wallace tells us, some products are winning some pretty trashy awards for being wasteful.
I just want to say one word to you. Just one word.
Yes, sir.
Are you listening?
Yes, sir, I am.
Plastics.
During the 60s, plastics may have been the wave of the future, but the future is now. And now, some plastics, at least environmentally speaking, are a dirty word.
Everywhere you look in the grocery store, there's a problem with over-packaging products or making products out of plastic that don't need to be.
It is estimated that each Floridian produces 1 ton of trash a year. But where are we going to put it all when our world is already on the verge of garbage overload? One solution? Generate less of it. Ross Crowe is an environmental lobbyist with the Florida Public Interest Research Group.
We go to buy some soup at the store, and it comes with this plastic bowl, and it comes with all this plastic wrapping, and then an extra cardboard box. Why do we need that?
Items that are wrapped, sealed, and boxed make up almost half of our garbage. Many environmentalists think all that extra packaging is unnecessary. Crowe's group, along with two other environmental organizations, came up with the Waste Maker Winner Awards for products they feel are guilty of excessive packaging.
What we wanted to do is send a simple and clear message to these people who are over-packaging all of our food, that we're tired of all this extra garbage.
One of the Waste Maker winners is Maxwell House Filter Packs Coffee.
What we see is a plastic lid, non-recyclable, non-disposable item, and a non-recyclable carton with a foil lid, and then each of the each coffee, again, is contained within a filter pack.
They suggest a more environmentally safe choice might be a tin of coffee, which is either reusable or recyclable.
I think this is the most classic example of an overpackaging job, a little plastic seal, a plastic lid for a container inside. Then you've got individually wrapped plastic containers with a little foil lid. How much packaging? And there's three more of these inside this one container. This is actually more packaging than product.
A simple alternative is fresh lemons and water. A spokesman for General Foods, which manufactures both Maxwell House and Country Time lemonade, says, quote, Maxwell House filter packs and Country Time sugar-free drink mix reduce product waste, increase convenience, and permit consistency of flavor through prepackaging of single-use amounts, end of quotation.
I think this is a super champion waste maker here.
Another wasteful winner is Aunt Jemima Express pancake mix, which comes in its own plastic mixing jug.
This may be a little more convenient, but every time you make breakfast, you're also making a piece of garbage that's polluting our world. Whereas instead, you can just buy Aunt Jemima in a box.
A representative for the Quaker Oats company, which produces Aunt Jemima pancake mix, says, quote, Quaker was the third company to enter the convenience niche after competitive products clearly demonstrated consumer demand for a quick and easy pancake mix with no mess. We're continuing to work on package refinements that also address environmental concerns. End of quotation. In response to their old-fashioned oatmeal that is topped off by a modern plastic ring, they responded, quote, "We plan to revise the oatmeal label to inform consumers how to separate the plastic rings that form the interlocking lid from the recycled paper portion of the package."
A lot of these products, particularly things like oatmeal, can just be bought in bulk. You can take your own container or get a bag at the store and put it in your own jar at home.
Le Menu Yankee Pot Roast Frozen Dinner was another waste maker. Before you even get to the meat of it, you've got four pieces of garbage: the box, a lid, a foil cover, and a plastic plate. Campbell Soup, Le Menu's parent company, had this to say about the dubious honor, quote, "We have not accepted the Wastemaker Awards. The creator of this award singled out two of our products and several from other companies, but their real quarrel is with single-serve packaging. They're against us for not being in the business of bulk foods." Campbell's Super Combo, a frozen soup and sandwich, comes in a box with a tray, a bowl, and is wrapped individually in plastic. Campbell says, quote, "Since the product's introduction, the company has taken several steps to reduce the overall amount of packaging in the product, and we are working full throttle to produce further improvements."
Why can't you just make your own sandwich and then just open a can of soup out of a tin can, which tin is a recyclable material?
Ovaltine also made the list because of its plastic lid. A company spokesman says they offer consumers a choice, quote, "Due to lower packaging cost, rich chocolate Ovaltine in the canister package is available to consumers at a cost 12% less than malt-flavored Ovaltine in a glass jar."
They think that the consumer wants to buy their product because it's convenient, but if they're starting to see that the consumer wants to buy their product because it's environmentally safe, then they're going to change, and they're going to start marketing their product in ways that are environmentally safe, because that's what we, the consumers, want.
We as consumers have to find a balance between convenience and responsibility. And if helping our environment isn't enough incentive, buying products that are packaged to excess are a lot more costly. And who do you think pays for that extra wrapping anyway?
Up next on Montage.
We landed in this country and began to exploit it.
Mother Nature hits 100.
We don't usually wish people happy birthday on this show, but tonight we're making an exception. With me to help spread the cheer is Channel 4 News environmental reporter Nick Vogel. Nick?
Well, Ed, this is one landmark birthday. Marjory Stoneman Douglas has done more for South Florida's environment than anyone I can think of. Her single biggest feat, the preservation and conservation of the Everglades. Now, Mrs. Douglas turned 100 today, and I had the pleasure of spending some time going down memory lane with the lady we like to call the First Lady of the Everglades.
My first impression was of the beauty of the bay, which is so wonderful. Well, I came to South Florida to be with my father. I was getting a divorce, and I hadn't any plans for more than that. But I liked it so much, of course, liked it very much indeed, loved it. I was on the original committee for the establishment of the Everglades National Park. So I got to know about the Everglades from that. It took us 20 years. You have to acquire the land, you see, and give it to the federal government. The Florida Federation of Women's Clubs gave a lot of the land, but we had to acquire the rest in various ways, by gift or by purchase, or however we could. President Truman dedicated it in 47. He came over the town of Everglades, dedicated the park then. I'm chiefly concerned now with restoring the Kissimmee River and cleaning up Lake Okeechobee. Those are our two great considerations now. Because when you talk about the Everglades, you have to talk about the Kissimmee-Okeechobee-Everglades Basin. You must remember you've got a lot of new people all the time. You have to keep on convincing them. So it's a constant battle. The difference we've made has been the education of the general public. Because, of course, you can't do anything without public opinion. I don't seem to get very tired. I go around making speeches, and I still write about it all the time. It always helps to have some great interest, you know. If you have some interest more than just your personal ones, it's much better for you. I've said it before. There's nothing else in the world like the Everglades.
Ed, she is pretty disarmingly direct. I expected maybe some warm and fuzzy recollection. Mm-hmm. I got a lot of oomph from this woman.
You know, she is. She loves those Everglades.
She does. Yes.
We do have one small gift to give you, Mrs. Douglas, after all you've given us. Montage photographer Dirk Muth won a national award for a photo essay he shot and edited on the Everglades. In your honor, here's his special Montage signature video. When you think of recycling, what most likely comes to mind are newspapers and aluminum cans, right? Channel 4 environmental reporter Nick Bogart is back with a story of a man who'll never tire of his old radials.
And we're coming in on Tire City here now.
Tires are an environmental inspector's nightmare. They can no longer be buried in landfills, and a lot of people are choosing to dump instead of paying for proper disposal.
Well, if anybody can find a use for these tires, they can make $1 million overnight.
Ruben Robledo is not getting rich on it, but he has sure found a use for old tires. He cuts and shapes them, turns them inside out, and adds imagination and paint.
Working with this, you realize that you have a lot of possibilities. The turtle, like a Betty Boop, doing the legs and the arms.
Ruben started making his hanging parrots and cats and fish and frogs for clients of his landscaping business. Some folks use them as planters, but most prefer to have Ruben's hang-ups hang alone. The raw materials certainly aren't hard to come by. Ruben says in making about 450 of his rubber creatures so far, he's already cleaned up a couple of tire dumps in Northwest Dade single-handed. But he is only one person.
I wish to only to get more time to get rid of all these ugly tires.
Ruben studied fine arts and was a graphic designer for a Cuban publishing house before finding his way to Miami 5 years ago. He says the idea of reusing tires as baskets or swings is widespread throughout the Caribbean, and remembers painting tires as a kid.
Because one of my uncle was a mechanic, so in the backyard used to be a lot of tires.
Ruben's radials are selling briskly now at Shaw's Nursery in South Miami. The extra money's not bad, but he says he's ready to break out of the animal kingdom.
The fun time is when you're creating something new.
Ruben's newest inspiration, hieroglyphics, based on Mayan designs he saw vacationing in Mexico last year. He expects this idea, too, will involve some trial and error.
The first tile that I made was very weird. It was a bird that was like a fish.
Ruben hopes his art with treads spreads to make the earth both cleaner and more beautiful.
Now, he would really clean up if he could find a way to eliminate the 1 billion tires Americans dispose of each year. If you have any questions or comments about this or any show, we want to hear from you. Call us at Montage Talkback, 1-900-246-TALK. That's 1-900-246-TALK. We'll air your comments on the next Montage. Each call costs 95 cents. Now that's all the time we have for this week's special edition of Montage. We're off next week, but we'll be back the following week. Before we go, we took our Montage camera to the Cutler Ridge Mall so you could have the last word on what you're doing for the environment. Till next time, I'm Ed Odell. Enjoy having the last word. Good night.
Okay, I take my coffee grounds and I put them around my plants and different, like even vegetables and stuff. When we're growing them outside.
I live in a condominium and we put everything in a plastic bag and it goes down the chute.
I'd be very happy to separate the garbage. Uh-huh. I'm the garbage man around our house.
I have little banks made out of the plastic stuff or the aluminum cans too. Uh-huh. For him, all over the place. So we're pitching it.
I give my newspapers to my neighbor and he takes them.
Mm-hmm. Do you separate your aluminum cans or bottles or glass or anything?
Aluminum cans, yes. Mm-hmm. No glass, I don't.
In Germany, you have to take care of the oil filter, of the racks, of everything. You have to separate everything else. Over here, you dump it in the ground. The Americans don't know anyway what's going on. That's a shame. It's really a shame.
We save all of our newspapers and take them to the recycling, right? Mm-hmm. And other than that, you know, we don't usually use aluminum, so.
Okay, yeah. So that's good.
I think it's a great idea, though. Mm-hmm. I really do.
I changed my oil out.